Hello, everyone. Welcome to another episode of Fabric Tech Talk Fridays. I'm your host, Swetha Mannepalli. Today, the topic is all about doing capacity estimations within Fabric. Where do you start? How do you go about that journey? For that, I brought none other than the man behind the mad math logic, Andreas, from our EMEA Global Black Belt Analytics team. Andreas, welcome to the show, and please introduce yourself.
Hi there, Swetha. Thank you very much. So my name is Andreas Bergstedt. I'm with the EMEA Analytics team. I help and support customers and partners in their journey to Azure and Microsoft Fabric.
Perfect. So Andreas, before we get into the lengths and depths of how do we start this journey, I want to sort of take a step back and understand why should organizations think about capacity estimation early in their Fabric journey?
So for obvious reasons, it's really important to understand what you're about to get yourself into. When we think about estimation, this is often something that comes into place when you want to stand up capacity and you want to start getting going with a project. And often in these phases, you know, if you understand kind of how much capacity you're going to need, you can also figure out what your financial requirements are going to be, like what kind of budget you're going to set, etc.
Wonderful, because you don't want to go to your CFO saying, hey, I'm going to spin up a new project and I don't know how much it costs, right? It doesn't look good. So we need to know what we are getting ourselves into. So that's great. Now, before we get into the details, how is Fabric capacity different than our traditional, some of the products? Let me take our own data products like Synapse or Azure Data Factory or Power BI for that matter. How is it different from those products to using Microsoft Fabric from a capacity needs perspective?
So that's a very, very good question. So Microsoft Fabric is based on a sort of shared capacity concept where you can collaborate with each other on different workloads. So you might have some data integration needs with Fabric Data Factory, or you might have some data warehousing or data engineering needs that need to run on Spark or Fabric Data Warehouse. And when we think about capacity, we see that like a compute resource pool. Whereas if you think of Synapse Analytics, you think of it perhaps as a set of compute isolated for one specific workload. So those are some of the main concepts that are different, that in Fabric, we have the shared collaborative environment where capacity is shared between many use cases.
Okay, that answers the part of the question, but opens a ton more questions. So I would, at Fabric Tech Talk Fridays, Andreas, we don't just do the talk. We want to show the tool, walk through the steps to make sure we make our viewers understand how our tools work. So let's get to the computer, share us what you got, and we can
sure. Let's get going. So we have this wonderful tool we built called the Fabric SKU Estimator. If we start and we get this ballpark figure and we get an idea of where we're going, we can start working with trials as well as a second step to understand sort of what workloads we are interested in and sort of what shape they're going to be, you know, what they're going to look like. And when we're starting with this trial capacity, Swetha, we also have the opportunity of working with the metrics app that then gives us an idea of how our workloads are going to consume. So we can then compare our initial estimates, our estimation, to what our how our workloads perform and consume. And then obviously after that, we can refine and get ready for our final purchasing decision.
Got it. So once you get your ballpark on what SKU you need using the Fabric SKU Estimator, then you move on to the actual Fabric trial capacity, look at the capacity metrics app. And then finally, the third step is refining once you purchase, whether you scale up, scale down. Did I get that right, Andreas?
Absolutely correct.
Perfect. Perfect.
Right. So in the estimator, let's have a look at a quick use case. So let's say we have a terabyte's worth of data. We run our batch process maybe twice a day, and we have about 700 pipelines that we execute per batch job or batch cycle. We might want to think about our data integrations. We select some data factory. We want to run some data engineering works using Spark. And also maybe we want to stand up a data warehouse, right? With Data Factory or with some of the workloads, we're going to be asked to provide some secondary input. So Data Factory, if we're considering using Dataflow Gen 2, we can put in an estimated runtime here. And in the background, the model will try to work out, depending on what your inputs have been, sort of how much consumption is going to be used there. But if we're not planning on using it, we don't know, we just put a zero in. Once we're done, hit calculate, and we get an estimate, right? So for this estimate, we're now going to recommend an F16 in capacity to operate this use case. And we can see here that Data Factory takes 9% of the workload, 42% is going to be from Spark. Data Warehouse is 43% of this F16. And then we can see that we got a headroom of about 2% in this capacity. So in this use case, we can say we're estimating that this workload operating is going to be an F16, but you're running really, really close to the next SKU. So maybe an F32 would be valid. But
Sounds good. I have a couple of questions here, Andreas. Yeah. So the first three inputs that you have, so what do you mean by total size of the data when compressed? So let's say, I'm not too deep into all the compressed data sets and whatnot. How do you think about that metric?
So when we ask about total compressed data state, we think of this from if you're running data lakes, maybe you've got on-prem Hadoop clusters, and you store data in those Hadoop clusters in compressed formats like Orc or Parquet. You basically, that data that you got sitting there is what you should take into consideration and take that for your entire production environment. So you look at not just your final sort of data warehouse workload, but you also think of it from your staging environment, your integration environment as well, right? So without going too technical, that's kind of how you think of it. If you don't have a compressed number, but you've got this blended large number, then so you might just know about your raw file sizes or what your raw data size is, then if we assume, average compression, we normally get a 6:1 compression ratio on average, depending on the data sets. You can take your uncompressed number and then divide it by 6 and put it in here in gigabytes.
Okay. This is super clear. Yeah, please keep going, Andreas. This is interesting.
Cool. So let's build on this use case. So let's say now we've got this idea of what our data engineering and data integration and data warehousing workloads are going to need. Let's add in some consumption. So let's say that we want to add our Power BI estate as well. So we scroll down and we say, well, we have, I don't know, 1,500 Power BI consumers. So there's quite a lot of active daily Power BI users or active Power BI users. And we've got another 25 Power BI reports creators, right? We're going to say our base or our maximum data model is about 10 gigabytes big, right? We hit calculate again, and we now get an F16. F64 is the recommendation. If we now add a little bit more, so let's say we want to do a migration. So instead of, when we're sizing our data warehouse, instead of using a greenfield approach, we say, hey, we're going to use our Synapse Analytics dedicated pool migration assistance. And we can say, hey, I have a 500 data warehouse units, right? Instead of this sort of greenfield approach, I tick that. And we're going to then provide you with an estimate based on that estimation. And here we can see that we've now gone to an F128. Where the data warehouse is accountable for roughly about 28% of that capacity. And we can see here with all the other workloads and use cases, we also have an unused capacity or headroom of about 40%.
Okay, this is awesome. Let me let me see what we covered with this demo so far. So we have covered, if you are coming from a data factory or a data engine sort of mindset, you have an option to drill down on what your estimates are going to look like. Similarly, if you're coming from a notebook Spark job perspective, we got that covered. Data warehouse, again, greenfield versus existing products. For example, Synapse. If you want to migrate from Synapse to Fabric data warehouse, we got that covered as well. Power BI, another big use case for us. So we catered that in. So do you want to add databases to this mix, Andreas, to see how it works?
Sure, why not? So if we add databases and Fabric, so let's say you got this application database that you want to run inside of Microsoft Fabric, what we ask for is how many vCores that you estimate that you're going to need. So maybe you've got 4 vCores on-prem for your current or in Azure SQL DB that you're planning on moving into Fabric. And then how much data you roughly have in there. So let's say we have another 10 gigabytes in that application database. And in terms of active daily hours, because we sort of work on an online auto scale kind of capacity with this, or a sort of semi-serverless work. So let's say active vCore hours is 8 hours a day that this application database runs in. You hit calculate, and now we add SQL databases into your estimate. And here you can also see that, since you already had headroom, you're just consuming into the estimate. So we're not saying you need separate capacity for this. And this goes into the, what is the difference between traditional capacity model or estimations for service, PaaS services like Synapse Analytics versus Microsoft Fabric.
Perfect. This really brings me into a good segue question on how do you really balance starting small and over-provisioning in Fabric, Andreas?
Well, how do you balance it? So it's a more of an art than a science, unfortunately. So if you look at, so the method is pretty much what we talked about before. You start with these estimates where you have an idea or where you're going. And then it's important to, once you start your proof of concept, either if through a trial capacity or through a smaller SKU, so let's say you deploy an F8, in this case, and you start working through it. It's important to monitor using the metrics app so that you can get an understanding of what sort of behavior you will get from your consumption perspective, right? Another thing that's also important to understand is when you balance your sort of your workload or your projects with your capacities, it's important to understand how some of the workloads behave so that you might want to split capacities up. So you might want to have an F64 for Power BI and final consumption. You might want to have another F64 to run your data engineering and your more industrialized workloads in the background.
Okay. So Andreas, with all that, any tips on workload management? I know you answered that partly, but how do you help or optimize your capacity usage within Microsoft Fabric?
So there are two ways of doing this natively in the product. The first thing is our guardrails. They will help you get enough headroom to ensure that you never run out of capacity. The other thing you can do, so if you're using a lot of Spark and data engineering workloads, you can use the online auto scale for Spark capacities.
Wonderful. Thank you so much. And again, what are you waiting for? Click on the link below, the AKA link that is on the screen, to get started with your Fabric adoption journey with the capacity estimator tool. Thank you so much, Andreas, for hanging out with us and sharing it the goodness.
Thank you everyone for watching. If you found this video valuable, don't forget, hit that like button.
If this is your first time visiting the Microsoft Fabric YouTube channel, be sure to smash that subscribe button.
Drop a comment below on what you'd like to see on future episodes of Fabric Tech Talk Fridays.
That's it for today. See you all next Friday for another deep dive into Microsoft Fabric.